Now, 5 months into the COVID pandemic, the government says we've already bottomed out, that it's only getting better from here. Joining us this morning, DNL Industries' Alvin Lau. Good morning, Alvin. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Mimi. Thanks for having me.
Have you? So, considering the huge losses that your peers are taking this year in the billions, 802 million peso profit for the first half, while still down, isn't so bad anymore, is it? I mean, what do you think is going to drive profit for the rest of the year?
Well, what we saw was that when ECQ started in the middle of March, a lot of people were really not sure what they could do and if they could stay open and so forth. But as the months progressed, it turns out people were able to figure out how to start operating again. So there were a lot of bottlenecks, things like problems with the supply chain, lack of public transportation, and so forth. But people were able to figure it out. Companies are able to realize what can and cannot be done. And so what we saw was that the worst month for us was probably April, and I would say for most companies, that's what happened. April was the worst. And then as each month came by, things were getting better. So May was better than April and so forth. That seems to be the case, at least for the second quarter. We are hopeful that we will see the same pattern in the second half. If you notice also, this MECQ, let's call it MECQ2, things seem to be a lot busier compared to the previous MECQ. There's more traffic on the road. There is a lot more people going about doing their business. So the economy looks like it's moving a lot more compared to the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Alvin, which segments of your business helped support profit for the first half, and which you expect to continue supporting for the rest of the year? I imagine it would not be domestic sales, but exports, and of course, you've got coconut-based products. Is that accurate?
Our exports are doing well, especially those which the Philippines has a big advantage in terms of sourcing of raw materials, things like not just coconut oil, but we make oleochemicals. Basically, those are chemicals made from vegetable oils. We use coconut oil to make MCT oils, for example. Those exports are working very well, particularly because there is a growing market appreciating better health, safety, and so on. And coconut oil is starting to show a lot of good things in terms of properties like antiviral, antifungal, antibacterial. We're also seeing strength in general on our non-food business, which is about half of our revenue. So our food side, unfortunately, is not showing much growth, and the prospects in the second half may not be that positive also, but the non-food side is still doing well.
You mentioned exports, Alvin. Which countries are your strong markets today, and what are your foreign counterparts telling you?
So our exports, that the markets that have seen growth are mainly in the countries which have a lot of appreciation and where the consumers are willing to spend a lot of money on things like the MCT oils and oleochemicals I mentioned earlier. So these would be mostly developed markets like the US, Europe, and so on. The customers are basically telling us that they need more of these products which are natural, non-toxic, environmentally friendly, and are effective. And that's the type of product that we are investing more research into to develop, to continue to reach our long-term goal of 50% exports eventually.
Where are we now? 50% is the goal. What is the current mix for exports and domestic sales today?
In the second quarter, we were at 31%, so still a way away. But before quarantine started, we were at around 20%. So we've made some progress.
Mm-hmm. Alvin, there's a game theory that may best sum up this pandemic. We went into this thinking it was going to be a one-round game. The virus hits us, we deal with it, we support everybody, then we all go back to normal. Then we find out it's actually a multi-round game, and multi-round strategies, I imagine, are very different, don't you think? I mean, what do you think could actually derail your more bullish outlook for the second half, where you're actually expecting to make $1 billion? Versus the $802 million you made in the first half?
Well, definitely what we know about past pandemics, for example, the Spanish flu, was that the second wave was much deadlier than the first wave. I think if we're not careful, if we don't follow all the best practices that the WHO have said, you know, with regards to wearing masks, social distancing, and so forth, if there is a much more deadlier wave, then definitely, you know, the government will be forced to do more lockdowns. And then I think very important as well, the confidence of people to go out, to consume products, to spend money. If that is affected, then definitely that will have a negative effect on us.
Mm-hmm. Alvin, one thing I also noticed during the COVID crisis is a lot of companies that used to do only B2B are now going B2C, that's business to consumer, whereas before, you know, we had to go to official network of distributors. Companies are now starting to reach out directly to consumers, essentially democratizing the network and removing the middlemen. Is this something that you notice or are experiencing yourself?
So 2 months ago, we put up our own website called O Superstore, where we are starting to sell some of our B2B products in smaller packaging, which would be friendlier for consumers. I anticipate, and I have seen many companies, you know, look around. A lot of these household brands are now much more available online. And I understand that this happened in other countries which were affected by SARS and MERS before. So countries like China and Korea, when SARS and MERS happened, online commerce took off and stayed. But more importantly, online payments started to make inroads as well. I believe that's what's happening now in the Philippines. So that's the opportunity that is happening in this crisis. Companies which are able to adapt to online, whether it's sales, accepting payments, or so forth, the new processes are allowing them to be able to service customers again and to be able to adapt and be more resilient if that next crisis comes along.
Mm-hmm. And of course, the middlemen themselves will have to rethink and pivot as well. Alvin, final question. You know, everywhere in the world, we're seeing how the pandemic has revived, in some ways, the plastic industry. There was even a Bloomberg article about how some are hailing plastic as the COVID-19 superhero. On the one hand, you've got this. On the other, a looming ban on single-use plastics. Plastic, I know, is also a major chunk of your business. What outlook are you taking on this?
So we have always been looking at ways to create a more sustainable, environmentally friendly alternative to plastic. This is something that we are continuing to do. We also recognize that during this time when the emphasis and importance, urgency on having sterile environments, on having containers which are clean, but cheap and light, plastic has its role. Having said that, we're not going to stop the work and investment in coming up with more sustainable replacement.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Alvin, for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much, Mimi.